Thank you. That I am thrilled to be here. That's so exciting. First of all, Chris Gilbo is my hero. I want to be I want to be Chris Gilbo when I grow up. I am older than Chris, but if there's ever a Benjamin Button scenario where I start aging in reverse. And I'm thrilled. I can't wait to meet you guys and hear your stories. My story, the 140 character version, is be bold, be experimental, and do it strategically. And I actually was not born bold. I think my natural disposition is kind of reserved and timid, but I have forced myself to be bold, and it has made my life better. Not always. Sometimes it's made my life a complete disaster, but overall, it has made my life better. As Chris mentioned, I'm a writer, and for my projects, I like to dive in and immerse myself in my topic, almost become a human guinea pig. A few years ago, I got interested in religion, and this was because I grew up with no religion at all. As I say in my book, I'm Jewish, but I'm Jewish in the same way the Olive Garden is Italian. So, no offense, great breadsticks, don't want to cast aspersions. But I had kids and I wanted to know what to teach them, if anything, about my heritage. So I decided one way to learn about the Bible would be to live it, to actually follow all the rules in the Bible. So I bought a stack of Bibles and I got a board of spiritual advisors, so ministers, rabbis, priests, scholars. And I made a list of every rule that I could find in the Bible. And this turned out to be a very long list, hundreds and hundreds of rules. And I wanted to follow them all without picking and choosing. I wanted to follow the famous ones, the Ten Commandments, love your neighbor, be fruitful and multiply. And I was fruitful and I had to, I had twin boys during the year. So I take my projects very seriously. But I also wanted to follow the lesser known rules. The Bible says, don't shave, you shall not shave the corners of your beard. I didn't know where the corners were, so I just let the whole thing grow. And here's what it looked like. So by the end, thank you for that reaction. It was, as you can imagine, I spent a lot of time at airport security with that look. It's true. There's also a rule in the Bible that says that you should stone adulterers. In the Hebrew scriptures, it says that. So I thought I should try, at least try. So I was able to stone one very quickly. It was in Central Park, and I was really in the middle of my experience getting into it. So I had the whole, I was wearing the robe and the sand. The sheep, I did not have the sheep. The sheep was a rental sheep just for a day. But the rest of it, I was like that. And a guy came up to me and he said, why are you dressed like that? And I said, well, I'm trying to follow all the rules of the Bible from the Ten Commandments to stoning adulterers. And he said, I'm an adulterer, are you gonna stone me? And I said, well, yeah, that would be amazing. Thank you, what a nice offer. And I took out a handful of stones because I had been carrying stones around for weeks, hoping to run into an adulterer, and here he was. So I showed it to him. They were very small, like pebbles, because I didn't want to, you know, go to jail. And he grabbed the stones out of my hand and threw them at my face. So I thought, an eye for an eye, I could throw one back at him. So that's how I checked that one off my list. Now, at the end of the year, I stopped stoning adulterers. I shaved my beard. But there are dozens of things from that experience that I take with me because it really was a life-changing experience. And I'll just give you two examples. The first, gratitude. The Bible talks about how you should say thanks for everything in your life. And I took this as literally as possible. So I would say thanks for everything. I'd press the elevator button and I'd be thankful that the elevator came. I'd get in the elevator and I'd be thankful that it didn't plummet to the basement and break my collarbone. So I was doing this, and it was a strange way to live, but it was also wonderful because you realize there are hundreds of things that go right every day that we totally take for granted, and we focus on the three or four that go wrong. So I try to keep that radical shift in perspective. Even today, I'm thankful this microphone is working. I'm thankful you guys are here. It's such a beautiful theater. Second lesson I just wanted to mention was the idea of how to become a better person. Because the Bible says that you shall not covet or lie or gossip. And I'm a journalist and I live in New York City. So that's like 80% of my day. So I was like, how do I do this moral makeover? And I discovered a secret, and that secret is deception. I pretended to be a better person. And if you pretend long enough, you start to become a better person. And there's a great quote from the guy who founded Habitat for Humanity that talks about this. He says that it's easier to act your way into a new way of thinking than to think your way into a new way of acting. The shorter version is fake it till you make it. So I tried to do that. The outer shapes the inner. And I remember during the year I had a friend who was in the hospital. I hate hospitals, I hate them. But I forced myself. I said, what would a good person do? And I acted as if I was a good person. And when you got to the hospital, I was sort of, I tricked my mind. And I was like, oh, I'm in the hospital, I must be compassionate. And I became a little more compassionate over the year. And I still try to keep this up today. My last book, as Chris mentioned, I've tried to be as healthy as possible. And I woke up every morning in despair because it's such a big topic and I didn't know what I was gonna write or make the deadline. So but I pretended I was confident and optimistic. I would force myself to call doctors and set up appointments. I forced myself to call my publisher and say, at the book release party, we really should only serve healthy drinks like kale martinis. And he was like, okay. And after a couple of hours of acting like I was confident, my mind caught up with my actions. So I love that strategy. And another experiment I did really reinforced that strategy. This one was about the founding fathers. And talk about boldness and chutzpah. I mean, the fact that these guys thought that their ragtag army of farmers could beat the greatest military force on earth. That's insane. That is like some serious delusional optimism. But I salute them for it. And I wanted to know more about them, and I read that George Washington, when he was a kid, a young boy, he wrote a list of 110 rules of life. And I thought, well, let me see what they are, and if I follow them, maybe I can become more like George Washington. And it's a great list. I recommend it highly. Some of them you expect, like it says that you should not gloat after a victory. That's good. You should honor your elders. There's other ones that I did not expect. The number two rule on George Washington's list is do not adjust your private parts in public. Which is a solid rule. You know, I'm not arguing with that. It just seemed number two, I would have put it like number 80, 81. And this was, I guess, this is a big problem back then. And this was before baseball players and hip hop star. But I will say, you never see George Washington adjusting his junk in a portrait. So he definitely paid attention. But in retrospect, it's not that weird because George Washington paid a lot of attention to the way he held his body, his poise. And he was known to have the best posture of any president. It was almost like a parody of posture, like the chest way out, the shoulders way back. And I thought, all right, let me try that. You know, it seems weird, small, but let me try it. My natural posture is terrible. I look like, hominid number two on the evolution charts. But I tried it, and the weird thing was that it affected the way I felt. It affected my mood, and I felt more confident and had more authority. Like I would tell my kids, stop licking the placemats, and they would actually listen to me. You know, it was great. So and it turns out George Washington was 250 years ahead of his time. I did not dress like that the whole time. That was, again, for a photo shoot. But he was 250 years ahead of his time because there have been some fascinating recent studies that say that the way you hold your body affects your mind. There's a great TED Talk by Amy Cuddy, a professor at Harvard. I loved it. And she says, if you hold your body in a power position, arms back, and arms open, shoulders back, that it raises your testosterone level, which raises your confidence, and lowers the cortisol level, which is your stress hormone. So again, the way you walk and talk really has an effect on how you feel. Another experiment I did in forced boldness was about education. When I graduated college, I felt that my brain was turning to mush. So I thought, what can I do? And I remembered when my dad was a kid, he started to read the encyclopedia from A to Z. He didn't quite finish, made it up to the middle of the letter B, around Borneo, because he had a life. But I thought, what if I try to finish what he began and remove that black mark from our family history? So I did, and I did for a year and a half. I spent 8 hours reading every day, reading the encyclopedia, and it was wild, it was fascinating, sometimes incredibly boring. And I think I had to get a new glasses prescription. I drove my wife to the edge. She started to penalize me $1 for every irrelevant fact I inserted into conversation. So she would say, like, I have such a headache. And I would say, did you know that the Bayer Aspirin Company invented heroin? Which is true. It was originally a cough suppressant and a very effective one, but it had some side effects. So I don't recommend it. But so it was fascinating, and I loved it, and I've forgotten 98% of what I learned, but I still remember a few of the bigger lessons. And one of those is related to boldness, chutzpah, because I read about thousands of these historical figures, and very few of them changed the world by staying at home and sitting on their couch. They got out there, they took risks, they failed and failed and failed and sometimes succeeded. And so there's one story in particular I remember of the poet Langston Hughes. And he was a bellboy, a struggling poet and a bellboy at a Washington, D.C. hotel. And a very famous poet named Vaclav Havel came into the hotel to eat breakfast. And Langston Hughes slipped him some poems along with his breakfast. And the next day, Havel announced that he had found the next great talent. And I love that because, you know, to use Langston Hughes' words, he did not let his dream be deferred. He just went for it. And I am not a great poet, believe me, but I did have a somewhat similar experience. I was, a few years ago, I got an email from a guy who was a freshman at the college I went to, Brown University. And he said he was going to be in New York over the summer, and he wondered if he could volunteer to be my assistant. And this is actually interesting timing, because I, at the time, was writing my book on the Bible. And in the Old Testament, it does condone certain types of slavery. And I was really struggling with this, because I am not pro-slavery. So I was like, how can I abide by this? And I thought, well, the closest thing in modern times that is legal to slavery is an internship. So I was like, all right. You can come work for me if I can call you my biblical slave. And he's like, all right, deal. And he was great. He was great. He did research. He made biblical bread, Ezekiel bread for me. And as a thank you to him, I took him on a trip to Jerry Falwell's church, because I was doing research. I was doing research on how different people interpreted the Bible. And we went down there, and he loved it, was fascinated. And on the way back, he said, what if I transferred for a semester from Brown to Jerry Falwell's college, Liberty University, and sort of wrote about my semester abroad in the Bible Belt? And I was like, that's a pretty good idea. So I hooked him up with an agent, and he wrote a proposal, and it turned out He did it. He wrote the book. It's a great book called The Unlikely Disciple by Kevin Roos. And it's wonderful because it's not a hatchet job. It's very balanced, shows the good of this lifestyle and the not so good. But he just had that chutzpah. He didn't go through alumni relations. He didn't blanket everyone with a form letter. He like targeted, and he wrote a very personal, very funny letter. And and that's how he did it. He took the first step. The first step is important to me, both literally and figuratively. The last project I want to talk about before I get to my new one is the health book, because this came about because I was in terrible shape. I wasn't traditionally fat, but I was what they call skinny fat. So I had I looked like a snake that had swallowed a goat. And so my wife told me I had to do something. So I did. I decided to follow all the medical advice and see what worked and what didn't. I took all the tests. I took, that's my sleep test. I didn't get a great night's sleep that night. I don't know why. I did all these different exercise regimens. That's stroller sizing. And this one is the caveman workout, where you go to Central Park and you literally throw boulders. And I wrote the book while walking on a treadmill, and which I love. I'm a big fan of the treadmill desk. I recommend it. One of the big takeaways from that experiment was the importance of cycles. And I think that a lot of our lives are ruled by different cycles. There's the vicious cycle that you know about, but there's also the virtuous cycle. And the vicious cycle is, you know, you're sitting on the couch, you're feeling kind of down, you know you should exercise, but you don't want to, so you just sit there and eat more and get more depressed and more, and it just spirals. But on the other hand, the virtuous cycle is when you force yourself to take that first step on the treadmill. You just force yourself to do it, and that gets the serotonin going. You're in a little bit of a better mood. You get more motivation. You wanna exercise. And that just keeps going in a positive feedback loop. So I am a big fan of virtuous cycles. Now, my new project that I want to tell you about is, I think, my boldest yet, and I am totally terrified and overwhelmed, but also very excited. And this one started because a few months ago I got an email out of the blue from a guy in Israel, and he said, "I've read your books, you don't know me, but I'm your 12th cousin." And my first reaction was, okay, when's he going to ask me to wire $10,000 to a Nigerian bank account? But he wrote, "I have a family tree with 80,000 people on it, including you and Karl Marx and several European aristocrats." And I was like, you know, first of all, I was like, if this is true, do I really want 80,000 relatives? I mean, I have enough trouble with some of the ones I have already. And I'm not going to name names, but they know who they are. But I was also fascinated, because here I am alone in my office, but I'm not alone at all. I am connected to 80,000 people around the world, and in a very real way. And it had a profound effect on me. And so I dove into the field of genealogy, and it turns out that this field is going through a fascinating revolution, partly because of DNA and genetic testing, but partly because of the internet. There are these websites now where you can work on a family tree with hundreds or thousands of other people. So it's not just you working on your own tree. If you put in your tree and say the A.J. Jacobs on your tree matches the A.J. Jacobs on someone else's tree, then these websites will let you merge. And you merge and merge and merge until you get these monster, mega family trees. And the biggest one that I'm on is on a website called Guinea, and it has no less than 77 million people, so all connected by blood or marriage, sometimes both, and I am on it. A lot of my friends from high school and camp are on it. A lot of you guys are on it, even if you don't know it. I was on it and I didn't even know it. It also has my cousin Gwyneth. She's on it. She is just. She's just 18 steps away, and she has no idea I exist, but we are a mishpuka, as the Jewish people say. There's also my cousin, Barack Obama. He is officially my aunt's fifth great aunt's husband's brother's wife's seventh great nephew. So practically my older brother. There's also my cousin, Kevin Bacon. As you can see, it's 28 degrees, so not quite 6 degrees, not quite 6 degrees, but we're getting there. Now, I am not boasting because you guys all have these relatives, because the truth is, you know that thing you heard when you were a kid, we're one big family. It's true, we are one big family, and 77 million is just the start. In a few years, it is very likely we will have a family tree of all 7 billion members of the human family. And hey, I love it. And I love this idea, and I hope that when it comes true, that we will be a little kinder to each other when we realize how closely aligned we are. And I decided this is my next book. I'm going to sort of be the biographer of the world family tree. And of course, I'm not doing it alone. I've got hundreds, thousands of collaborators at great websites. One is called Guinea, which is part of my heritage. Another is WikiTree. And these people are so involved, and they will help newcomers figure out how you're connected to the family tree, how you're connected to Obama or whoever you like. They both have these tools now. They're so into it that one is 100 degrees of AJ, where you can put in your name and figure out how you're related to me. So I am super excited about that. There are challenges, because there's some branches are much more accurate than others. But I am very confident the more people who join, the more documentation we get, the more DNA evidence, it's going to become more and more accurate. Now, a lot of people say, you know, this is cool, or they say this is totally terrifying, you know, depends. But they say, is it important? And I would argue, yes, it is important for a few reasons. I'll give them to you really quickly. One, this thing has scientific value. This is an unprecedented history of the human race. And there are scientists at MIT already studying it to see how diseases are passed down. So it has huge medical implications. Number two, it brings history alive. And when I told my kids that we were linked to Albert Einstein, they were, you know, now Albert Einstein is not just some old dead white guy with weird hair. He is Uncle Albert, and they want to know about him. Now, it goes both ways. I am also connected to Jeffrey Dahmer, the serial killer, although that's through my wife's side. I just want to make that. Sorry, honey. She is not here. She was supposed to come, but not here, so now I can say that. It just stresses the interconnectedness of us all. We share 99.9% of our DNA. And I've talked to scientists, it's hard to estimate, but the estimates are that everyone on Earth is 50th cousins or less, and usually a lot less. And that's by blood. By marriage, it's much closer. So my hope is that this will result in a kinder world. Now, I have 3 sons, so I know how they fight. I know all about family feuds, but I also know that humans have a tendency to treat each other with a little more kindness when they are family, as opposed to strangers. And my hope is that this will pay off, and I've seen it happen. I'll give you a trivial example. You know Judge Judy, the TV personality? I always found her incredibly abrasive. But then I discovered she's my 11th cousin, 4 times removed, and I'm like, you know what? she's not so bad. She's probably a sweetheart underneath all that. And I've heard this change in perspective from lots of people working on these trees. And I am hopeful that these trees are going to show that it's bad news for bigots, because whatever ethnic group you happen to hate, you are cousins with them. Where there's no such thing as pure blood. That is a myth. We are all mixed together. And a lot of the terrible things that humans have done to each other over the centuries is because one group thinks another group is subhuman. And we can't do that anymore, because we're not just the same species, we're the same family. Thank you. Now, so I have these 77 million cousins and growing. I thought, what can I do with it? And that's when I decided, you know what? I'm going to throw a party. And I am going to throw next summer the biggest, and I hope the best, family reunion in history. and you guys are all invited. You are, every one of you, you are all my cousins. We just have to figure out how. And I am hopeful that it will be the best event of 2015, not counting WDS. You cannot top WDS. But I am very excited. It actually has a little WDS flavor. I see it as a family reunion meets WDS meets like Bonnaroo. Because there's going to be speeches from interesting cousins, both famous and non-famous. There's going to be music and scavenger hunts and exhibits and all sorts of things. And I've been going around the country trying to recruit cousins to come. A few weeks ago, I went to Houston to talk to my cousin, President George H.W. Bush. Now, I'm a Democrat, but but I do love the elder Bush, and he, one of my second cousins married a really waspy guy, so that's how we got into that line. And and talk about chutzpah. This is what I'm talking, I just called up his chief of staff and I said, you know, I'm cousins with the president, and could I come and interview him? And she's like, sure. And and it was a great interview. I told him that he's actually very closely related to Bill Clinton, and they love Bill Clinton nowadays. And Mrs. Bush said, you know, I always thought Bill Clinton was my son from another mother. So there you go. Bill Clinton and him. I went and I interviewed Daniel Radcliffe as Harry Potter, a lovely young man. I love him. He said at the end, he said, I know this is a little creepy, but I would love to know how I'm related to my girlfriend. So I am so I am working on that. And then here's some other ones. Some that's from Ron Swanson from Parks and Recreation, a great show. This is Steven Pinker, who's a brilliant Harvard professor, and Penn Jillette, the magician. And this is, at the bottom there is Chrissy Teigen, who is a Sports Illustrated swimsuit model. I actually don't know how I'm related to her yet, but I felt it was important to meet her, so I tracked her down. And of course, my cousin Abraham Lincoln, I was able to get him to take a picture. And I'm also recruiting people by DNA tests, because you know there are these services like 23andMe and Family Tree DNA. You spit into a tube and you send it off, and they will compare it to their database and tell you all of the hundreds, even thousands of cousins you didn't even know you had. And I found some very interesting ones, including my wife. So she is my distant cousin. I thought this was interesting. She was not happy. But you know, we've heard all the jokes. Our kids are fine, no extra limbs. But we're not the exception. If you go back far enough, everyone is married to their cousin, if you're married. So I'm hoping all of these people will come next summer to the grounds of the New York World's Fair, which is where this is being held, at an awesome venue called the New York Hall of Science, which is where the Makers Fair took place. If you've ever been there, it's a great event too. No WDS, but a great event. And it's got the mini golf, and for the kids, it's indoors and outdoors. And I am not going to make any money on this. In fact, I'm probably going to lose money. But I'm trying to get sponsors because I want it to be any money that does get made will go directly to Alzheimer's, which affects my family and the human family. It's a devastating disease. Thank you. So underfunded and so devastating. 44 million members of the human family have it. Morgan Spurlock, who did Super Size Me, is going to be making a movie about it. So if you come, you can be in the movie. And by the way, everyone is allowed. All 7 billion members of the human family are invited. But if you can find a link to me, then you get a little bracelet and can be part of the world's biggest family photo. I hope. You guys broke a world record. I'm trying as well. And so I'm very excited. And by the way, I'm going to try to live cast it all over the world. So if you can't make it to New York, you can still be a part of history. And I'm totally overwhelmed. I'm out of my depth because it's a huge, I got to get 5,000 people to break the world record. And I have wonderful volunteers working on this with me. But if any of you guys want to be part of history, if you want to meet amazing cousins, and by the way, this is a crazy way to network. You know, you guys, like, because, you know, you call people up and say, I'm your cousin, we should do some, you know, would you like to take a meeting? And they're like, all right, I guess I should. So if you want to join the family tree, it's remarkably easy. Go to globalfamilyreunion.com and we'll take care of you. And because I want you all there, as I said, you're my cousins. And in fact, I have found already two cousins here at the World Domination Summit. And I thought I'd bring them up here for a little mini family reunion before the family reunion. Can we bring them out? There's my cousins. Hello, family. How are you? Here we have Adina and Karen. And tell us where you're from and what you do.
I'm Karen Sargent. I'm from San Diego. There's a good contingent right there. And I am a project manager and course designer, so I help people create really great digital products.
Awesome.
And I'm Adina. I'm from Seattle, Washington. I'm a multimedia travel content creator, and I'm here at WDS because I'm starting my very first small business, creating handmade travel products for the cause.
Awesome. I love it. I don't even need it. But these guys I got through because one of the best ways to connect is if you have a famous or semi-famous ancestor, and I have that same ancestor, we can make it. So we have Pocahontas for Karen, and I have Pocahontas, so we're cousins. And Dina has Richard Henry Dana, who is an author 2 years before the mast, I believe. Anyway, I love that these guys are here, and I thought, since I see WDS as a family as well, I thought maybe we could kick off the day, because you guys have an awesome day planned. I am really excited to see these other speakers. We could kick it off with just a quick sing-along. So I thought we would hit it, and I'm a terrible singer, so I...
It runs in the family.
It runs in the family. And yeah, come on up, and please sing along, stand up if you want. And Sister Sledge, I actually am hiring them to come to the World Family Reunion. So, and please turn my mic down because you don't want to hear me sing. All right.
Thank you.
family. Have a great, of course, cousin.
Hey, thank you.
That's a good hug. You're a good hugger. I'll see you next year. I can't wait to meet you. Have a great day. It's going to be awesome.